Please stand.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Amen.
In the waters of baptism, Nathan, Emma, and Grant died with Christ and rose with him to new life. May thou now share with him eternal glory. Good morning and welcome to the Good Samaritan campus of St. Luke the Evangelist Parish. As we continue with our funeral liturgy, we now place these small wooden crosses as a reminder of their faith in our Lord Jesus Christ and the saving power of his cross. In a little while, their names will be affixed to the crosses and they'll be placed on the wall there along with the crosses of others from our parish who have gone before us. They hang there throughout the year as a reminder to pray for them, but also to pray for those who've lost someone they love so much. In November, around All Souls Day, you'll be invited to return to the parish to receive the cross as we gather to celebrate the lives of all of those who have gone before us, marked with the sign of faith. I know you have a million things on your mind, but I invite you to listen really closely to the prayers of our funeral liturgy. I think you'll find they're not only very ancient, but very beautiful, and I think they'll bring some comfort. And so let us pray. O God, who are mercy for sinners and the happiness of your saints, give, we pray, to your servants, for whom today we perform the fraternal offices of burial, a share with your chosen ones in the blessedness you give, so that on the day of resurrection, freed from the bonds of mortality, they may come before your face through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen.
I invite you now to be seated as we hear the reading of the Word of God. May we have our first reader, please.
A reading from the Book of Lamentations. My soul is deprived of peace. I have forgotten what happiness is. I tell myself my future is lost, all that I've hoped for from the Lord. The thought of my hopelessness, poverty, is wormwood and gall. Remembering it over and over leaves my soul downcast within me. But I will call this to mind as my reason to have hope. The favors of the Lord are not exhausted. His mercies are not spent. They are renewed each morning. So great is his faithfulness. My portion is the Lord, says my soul. Therefore, I will hope in him. Good is the Lord to one who waits for him, to the soul that seeks him. It is good to have hope in silence for the saving help of the Lord, the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Thessalonians. We do not want you to be unaware, brothers and sisters, about those who have fallen asleep, so that you may not grieve like the rest who have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose, so too will God, through Jesus, bring with him those who have fallen asleep. Indeed, we tell you this on the word of the Lord, that we who are alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord will surely not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself, with a word of command, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trumpet of God, will come down from heaven, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. Thus, while we shall always be with the Lord, therefore console one another with these words, the word of the Lord.
Be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Now that very day, the first day of the week, two of the disciples were going to a village 7 miles from Jerusalem called Emmaus, and they were conversing about all the things that had occurred. And it happened that while they were conversing and debating, Jesus himself drew near and walked with them, but their eyes were prevented from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing as you walk along?" They stopped, looking downcast. One of them, named Cleopas, said to him in reply, "Are you the only visitor to Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place there in these days?" And he replied to them, "What sort of things?" They said to Jesus, "The things that happened to Jesus, the Nazarene, who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people. How our chief priests and rulers both handed him over to a sentence of death and crucified him. But we were hoping that he would be the one to redeem Israel. And besides all this, it's now the third day since this took place. So women from our group, however, have astounded us. They were at the tomb early in the morning and did not find the body. They came back and reported that they'd indeed seen a vision of angels who announced that he was alive. Then some of those with us went to the tomb and found things just as the women had described, but him they did not see. And Jesus said to them, 'Oh, how foolish you are! How slow of heart to believe all that the prophets spoke! Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and enter into his glory?' Then beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them what referred to him in all the scriptures. As they approached the village to which they were going, he gave the impression he was going on farther. But they urged him, 'Stay with us, for it's nearly evening and the day is almost over.' So he went in to stay with them. And it happened that while he was with them at table, he took bread, said the blessing, broke it and gave it to them. With that, their eyes were opened and they recognized him, but he vanished from their sight. Then they said to each other, 'Were not our hearts burning within us while he spoke to us on the way and opened the scriptures to us?' So they set out at once and returned to Jerusalem, where they found gathered together the 11 and those with them who were saying, 'The Lord has truly been raised, and it has appeared to Simon.' Then the two recounted what had taken place on the way and how he was made known to them in the breaking of the bread." My sisters and brothers, the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
For those of you who haven't met me, I'm Father Joe, and on behalf of myself and our whole church family, please know of our deepest sympathies. Words just can't convey. And our prayers as well, and the prayers of so many other people, especially for Nikki and Aubrey and Sam and Jan and Ed and Pat, to David and Natalie and Mike and Amy and Maddie and Tyler and McKinley and Tatum and Kenzie and all of those of you who loved them so much. You don't know how much your prayers have helped the family to get through something that's unthinkable. That scripture passage, the story of the road to Emmaus, is pretty amazing. These two guys had followed Jesus from town to town. They were disciples, not just kind of casual observers. They were probably kind of like Swifties that go from town to town to town, follow the concert tour. But the hotel rooms were a lot cheaper back then. But they were following him, and from the time they were little, they were told one day a Mashiach, an anointed one, a Messiah will come. And he'll raise Israel to its final former glory as it was under King David and King Solomon. Because they'd been conquered by the Assyrians, and then they were conquered by the Babylonians, and they were conquered by the Persians, then they were conquered by Alexander the Great and the Greeks, and then they were conquered by the Romans, and the Romans were horrible. They suppressed them. And they just longed for this time when someone would come, a great prophet, a Messiah, and raise it up again. And when they heard this Jesus talk and they saw the love in his eyes, the way he opened up the scriptures, it gave them life. They thought, this must be the one. And then they saw him arrested and beaten and spit on and mocked, and then forced to carry that awful cross all the way up the hill to Calvary. As they nailed him to the cross, they gambled for the only thing he owned on earth, his clothing. They were crushed because in their Old Testament mentality, they couldn't understand how somebody who was innocent, let alone the Messiah, could suffer, especially such a horrible death. You see, they thought what goes around comes around here on earth. If you were a good person and you treated people well, you'd have a beautiful wife and beautiful children and all the goats and cows you could want. But if you were evil, if you cheated people, something awful would happen to you. And so when they saw this happen to Jesus, they were crushed. They weren't just leaving behind the town of Jerusalem. They were leaving behind all their hopes and dreams until Jesus appeared in his glorified body and they didn't recognize him. He said, "What are you talking about?" And they looked at him like he was crazy. "You're the only one that doesn't know what just happened." He said, "What? This Jesus, the Nazarene, we thought he was the Messiah, but they not only handed him over to a death sentence, they crucified him." And Jesus shook his head and he said, "How foolish can you be? Didn't you ever read the Old Testament about the suffering servant?" And one by one, he opened the scripture to them and explained to them that he had to suffer to pay the price for our sins. Not for his sins, but for ours, so that we would have hope and eternal life. And as they got to Emmaus, it was getting dark, and they said, "Please, Jesus, stay with us." Well, they didn't know it was Jesus yet. "Please, stranger, stay with us." And he sat there, and he took the bread, said the blessing, broke it, and gave it to them, just as I'll do in just a few minutes. And with that, he disappeared, and they realized all along they'd been talking to Jesus himself. And they ran all the way back to Jerusalem in the pitch dark just to tell them it wasn't the end of the story. And that's what we celebrate today. This isn't the end of the story. It's hard to imagine that anyone could fit in such a small space. But they're not in there. They're in your hearts. And they're standing before Christ probably even as we speak. That this isn't the end of the story. It's just the beginning of the next chapter in their lives. A lives that lasts through all eternity. They were amazing in their own right. Nate was kind of a perfectionist. I love the story of when he was younger, he wanted to have a black lab and to get his parents to give it to him. And his mom said, "Well, I don't know. We don't know much about these labs." So he went to the to the library in his school, researched everything he could find out about black labs, and came back with a report with pictures and everything about, this is the dog you gotta get. And he was one of those people that just excelled at sports. And until he had to have his knee operated on, he was a contender for Division I sports player. And he excelled at whatever he did. He wanted to dig in and be the best that he could to be. And he wanted his kids to be the same. He knew a lot about baseball, but when it came to softball, he dug in and researched, and he was coaching. He was teaching Emma. He wanted her to be the best that she could be. And the interesting thing is that the kids all got that. They inherited that from him. And what I think they inherited from their mom is them wanting the other kids to be as best that they could be, even if it meant they were better than them. Because you see, a candle never loses any of its brilliance in lighting another candle. And that's what Emma was like. She always wanted everybody to be the best that they could be. And she was one of those people that would light up a room, and she was the eternal optimist. When they were telling me about her, I couldn't help but think of a story I heard one time. There was this man who had twin kids, and one of them was the eternal optimist. No matter what happened, everything was great. And the other one was the eternal pessimist. No matter what happened, they would whine and cry about it and complain, like the world was terrible. And he went to McDonald's one day and was talking to his best friend. He said, I don't know what I'm going to do. They need to learn that the world isn't always rosy. There's pain and suffering. And then the other one, to let them know that the world can be a beautiful place. It's not all gloom and doom. He said, I think I know what I'll do. Their birthday's coming. So he went out and bought every toy he could imagine, had them wrapped in beautiful wrapping paper, and put them in the one boy's room that was the pessimist. And then the other one he filled with horse manure. They brought them home from school, and they said, okay, kids, it's your birthday. Go up into your rooms and get your gifts. So he went up into the room, and he heard, standing at the bottom of the steps, one of them wailing and crying. He said, found the horse manure. And the other one was giggling and laughing. Oh, he found all the presents. Finally, he's smiling. He goes up to the top of the steps, and to his great amazement, the one who's crying and whining is the one who has all the gifts. And he said, son, how could you be so upset? You've got every toy in the world. He said, look at this, Dad. This is red, and it was probably painted with lead paint. And look at these things. They were made in Sri Lanka. They were probably made by little kids 12 years old with bleeding fingers working 12 hours a day. And he said, son, what am I going to do with you? He goes into the other room, and he sees the other child grabbing hands full of horse manure and throwing it up in the air, digging and laughing and giggling. He said, son, how could you be so excited? Your room's filled with horse manure. And he said, Pap, I know one thing. If there's this much horse manure, there's a pup, there's a pony at the bottom of that pile. That was Emma. She was always looking for the pony. She was always looking out for other people. I love the story about how she went into, I think it was Maddie's softball team, and went down into the dugout and gave this an inspirational speech to all of the kids, and they were just on the edge of their seats, and the coach said, you ever want to come back again. You can give them a speech every week. And she wanted the other kids to love the game. And as good as she was, there was one game I think she was losing in the first inning, like 11-0 because of all the errors. But when the kids came off the field, she stayed by the dugout and waited for each one of them to come by and gave them a high five. And to the ones that did a good job, she congratulated. And to the ones that made an error, he said, it's okay, we'll get them in the next inning. It's all right. We're a team. That's why she lived her life. I wanted to ask you to do something strange. Could you, if you have a cell phone, take it out now, turn the flashlight on and hold it up. I want you two to stand up now and turn around. You see all these lights? When we gather together, that light becomes so brilliant. Any one little light doesn't mean anything, but when you gather them together, it makes all the difference in the world. And that was what Emma was all about. She was one of those people that became a light to the world. It says in Scripture, I am the light of the world. You don't hide a light under a bushel basket. And it's so amazing. This candle represents Christ, the light of Christ. We light it three times in the life of the church. Once is at the Easter Vigil when new people are coming into the church and the deacon comes part way down and lifts it up and says, Christ our light. And then he comes a little further and lifts it up again, Christ our light. And then the third time, lifts it as high as he can, Christ our light. And what symbolizes is that when we do a baptism, which is the second time we light the candle, we take another little candle and light it off of them, hand it to the parents and say, receive the light of Christ. Your job is to keep that little flame of faith that was just lit in that baby's heart burning as long as it can, at least until they're able to keep that light going on their own. That's your job, your sacred responsibility. And there, you've heard stories of people having a near-death experience and seeing this long, dark tunnel. And at the end of the tunnel, there's this brilliant light. It's like looking into the sun, but it doesn't hurt your eyes. And you're just magnetically drawn to it. That's the light of Christ himself. And the idea is that when he looks down, when he sees us one day, and he looks back and sees that light in our heart, he'll see it, his own light reflected in our lives. If we live that way, Emma lived that way. And her little brother, she influenced him, Grant, too. He was a character in his own right. He took after his dad, he loved mechanical things, and he must have driven Nikki crazy whenever she would do the wash because you never knew what was going to be in his pockets. It was either a screwdriver or a pair of pliers or a wrench or some nuts and bolts, and they'd ask him, why do you have all this stuff in your pocket? You never know when something needs to be fixed. And he just loved working with his hands. And one day they were at a game, and I guess the game was getting boring. And he went off into the woods, and he comes back, and he had a stick, and he had a piece of string that he found somewhere tied on the ends of it. Found another stick with a notch in it, and he made his own bow and arrow just to amuse kids. I think if he could have fit a chainsaw in his pocket, he would have done it. He was kind of like a young version of MacGyver. But he was one of those kids that just loved other kids, and they loved him. The coaches loved him because he was very coachable. He wanted to be the best he could be, like his dad. And he wanted the other kids, just like Emma, to be the best they could be, too. And whenever you would go anywhere, it was like being with a movie star. All the other kids would come running up to him and said, Grant, how you doing? That's the kind of love they had in their hearts, the kind of love they shared with other people. We gather at a funeral really for three reasons. One is to be here for the family and friends who have lost someone they love so much. And I hope as the days and weeks go by, little things remind you of them, whether it's Grant spitting pumpkin seeds, sunflower seed shells at people in the stands to get them to laugh, or someone at a game cheering the other ones on, screaming at the top of their lungs. I hope when you think of them that you'll be there for one another, because that's what family's all about. You know how much they would want you to stick together like glue. Second reason we gather at a funeral is to pray for the people that passed. No matter how good we are, we all sin in some small way. I think right about now she's explaining to Jesus about the time it was Thanksgiving, he took the big serving spoon and started dipping into the dessert with her aunt screaming, what are you doing? She was hungry. And isn't it amazing that the one picture, the last picture that's in the obituary of her, has two crosses on her cheeks. Tells you what was important to her. Tells you what should be important to you. The last and the most important reason we gather at a funeral is an opportunity to look at our own lives. Where will we spend eternity? Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Where I'm going, you know the way. They knew the way. She, Emma, at night would read the Bible, and she sometimes would send letters of encouragement to her friends and sometimes a picture in a frame, and she put Isaiah 60:22 on it. It says, though you're a small nation, I will make of you a clan. I will make of you a great nation. And that's how she lived her life, trying to create a clan, whether it was on the basketball court or whether it was on the softball field. You were all important to her. That light that you showed, those people will be praying for you for a long, long time and praying for them. You're never, ever, for the rest of your life, ever going to be alone. So you've got them looking over you, and you've got all of these people. And I can tell you from this moment on, if you're here, you're part of the clan Bogacki forever. Don't forget to keep them lifted up in prayer. And for you, just remember, this isn't the end of the story. It's just the beginning of the next chapter. What greater thing could you ever want a desire for your family, to them to spend eternity in heaven. These kids were a light in the world. That light hasn't gone out. Their role is done. When Jesus was at the Last Supper, he said, Father, my disciples, they're your gift to me. I wish that where I'm going, I could take them with me. My work is almost done. I don't ask you to take them out of the world. I just ask you to watch over them as I did while I was here. Your job now, your sacred responsibility is to pass that faith that they had on to the next generation that hasn't even been born yet. No pressure yet, but when you have grandchildren, they better know about Jesus. And so we pray for them. Eternal rest grant unto them, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon them. May they rest in peace. Amen. May their souls and the souls of all the faithful departed, for the mercy of God, let the church say a hearty amen.
Amen.
You can do better than that. Let the church say amen again.
Amen.
Okay, you have potential. And let us rise as we offer our prayers and our petitions before the Lord's table.
Please respond, Lord, hear our prayer. For Nate, Emma, and Grant, who in baptism were given the pledge of eternal life, that they now be admitted to the company of the saints, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our deceased relatives and friends, Sam and Kay Alloy, Frank and Dorothy Horniak, Edward and Virginia Baker, and Edward and Mary Louise Bogacki, and for all who have helped us, that they may have the reward of their goodness, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the family and friends of Nate, Emma, and Grant, that they may be consoled in their grief by the Lord, who wept at the death of his friend Lazarus, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all of us assembled here to worship in faith, that we may be gathered together again in God's kingdom, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
One of the amazing things about Emma is that as she would encourage people coming off the field, that her grandfather used to coach for 30 years said, I've never seen anything like it. The younger kids are starting to do the same thing. That legacy has been passed on. And so we pray for all of those young people that were influenced by these three, that God would always hold them close to his heart. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear us.
Heavenly Father, we gather as a family of faith, united in our love for them and our love for you, and ask these prayers through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
I invite you now to be seated as we prepare our altar for the gifts.
Thank you.
my sisters and brothers, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands
for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church. Be near, O Lord, we pray to your servants, on whose funeral day we offer you this sacrifice of conciliation, so that should any stain of sin have clung to them, or any human fault have affected them, it may by your loving gift be forgiven and wiped away through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
Lord God, we give you thanks for the gift of Nate and Emma and Grant, if only for a little while. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Jesus Christ our Lord. In him the hope of blessed resurrection has dawned, that those saddened by the certainty of dying might be consoled with a promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful Lord, life has changed, not ended. And when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for them in heaven. And so will all the angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim. I invite you now to kneel or sit, whichever is your tradition. You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you've created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. You never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread. Giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice. Giving you thanks, he said the blessing, gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. But this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray upon the oblation of your church in recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself. Grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an everlasting offering to you so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with Saint Luke and with all the saints on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth with your servant Francis, our Pope, David, our bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy and religious, and the entire people you've gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family you've summoned here before you. In your compassion, have mercy on us all, and gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. Remember your servants, Nate and Emma and Grant, whom you've called from this world to yourself. Grant that they who were united with your Son in a death like his may also be one with him in his resurrection. But from the earth he will raise up in the flesh those who have died and transform our lowly body after the pattern of his own glorious body. To our departed brothers and sisters too, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory when you will wipe away every tear from our eyes. For seeing you, our God as you are, we shall become like you for all the ages and praise you without end through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Together let us rise, as at the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, together we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give to you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
My sisters and brothers, let us offer one another the sign of peace.
Thank you.
My sisters and brothers, behold Jesus Christ. Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I'm not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed. For nearly 2,000 years, it's been our firm belief as Catholics that Jesus Christ himself is now present on our altar. That just as he changed common water into wine at the wedding feast at Cana, that he changed bread and wine into his body and blood. In a moment, we'll invite those of you who are Catholics and spiritually prepared to come and receive of the Eucharist. If you happen to be visiting us from a different faith or denomination, if you'd like to come forward and just put your hand on your heart, it would be my great honor today to be able to give you a blessing. And if anyone is in need of a low-gluten host, please just let me know. The body of Christ.
Amen.
The body of Christ.
Amen.
The body of Christ. The body of Christ.
Amen.
The body of Christ. The body of Christ. The body of Christ.
Amen.
The body of Christ.
We are one Lord in this one.
unto me shall not hunger, and who believe in me shall not thirst. No one can come to me unless the Father beckons, and I will raise you up, and I will raise you up, and I will raise you up on the last day. The bread that I will give is my flesh for the life of the world, and if you eat of this bread, you shall live forever. You shall live forever, and I will raise you up, and I will raise you up, and I will raise you up on the last day.
at that time. Right. A lot of the stories may be repeated here. Father Joe did such a great job, and the stories that were told are the ones that kind of resonate with all of us. Sorry. Nobody should have to stand up here and talk about a 17-year-old and 14-year-old that are no longer with us. But I'm going to try to represent them the best that I can in hopes to make them and my sister proud. Emma and Grant were truly the best. I'm not saying that because they were my niece and nephew, but they truly were the most positive, loving, and uplifting kids I have ever been around. I hope that by the time I'm done, if you did not know them personally, you can visualize how amazing they were. And if you did know them, you can someday share your stories with all of us as well. Be better today than yesterday. That was a bolded statement on Emma's codes through life, a statement that she truly lived by, and a statement she encouraged others to live by as well. Yes, as a 17-year-old, Emma had a plan that she titled Emma's Codes Through Life. She was motivated, she set goals, and she did whatever was needed that she needed to do in order to accomplish them. I'm going to share with you her rules to life that she had written in multiple places as a constant reminder for her to do better today than yesterday. My hopes of sharing this are that all the young athletes in the room can continue to look up to her and use her story as a role model, just as her cousins always do. I know that my entire Valley Rage team, as well as Aubrey Steel City Athletics team, have learned so much from all of her motivational pep talks. This is what she had written, her three rules to life. Do right, know right from wrong. Do everything to the best of your ability. And last, show people you care. Things that you can change and that can change you 5 years from now. The books you read, the people you meet, and the dreams that you dream. And last, how to be successful. Attitude. Have a good, positive attitude. Passion. You must have the drive to win or to be successful. Number three, stay focused. Have a goal and focus only on that goal. Number four, be a dreamer. Anything is possible. Always dream big. Number five, create a positive environment. Lift people around you up and don't be negative. I don't know about you, but when I was 17, I did not have goals or any plans like this. This just shows you how motivated and driven she was. She set a goal at the beginning of her junior year to reach 300 strikeouts. We all know that she exceeded that goal and was already working towards her next one. Emma, we know you were playing up there with Grant, with the best pitcher's mound, most well-groomed field, and all the tacky towels that you ever wanted in your back pocket. When you would ask anyone about Emma, they all had a similar response. She was the light in every situation. She always knew when someone was upset or had a bad day, and she always found a way to make them smile. Whether it was a hug, a goofy photo, a nice card or letter, or just acting like a complete fool, she found a way to lighten the mood. On the softball field, she was known to be the first one to hustle off the field, and she waited to give every single player a high five and a positive pep talk before they walked into the dugout. If she wasn't happy with her performance, she never showed negative emotion on the field. She would go home and work harder until she felt confident enough. She played on many different teams and attended numerous college camps. Again, the feedback was always positive. There was not a single person who did not love and admire Emma, unless you were playing against her and had to face her fastball. Even then, her positive demeanor and glowing smile made it impossible not to love her. I remember her being in the dugout of my 10U travel team where her sister Aubrey played. She found a positive for every player and was sure to tell all of them how great they were. Her words of wisdom after games resonated with my players, as we still reference her positive attitude and outlook on life to this day. She always reminded them that they were going to fail. It's how they reacted to failure that mattered. Off the field, there was nothing more that she loved than her family, her pets, and her friends. Even though she was a beast on the softball field, her gentle heart would always shine through. She carried around her baby blanket everywhere she would go and would sneak a few sniffs when she thought nobody was looking. On holidays, she was always the loud and fun cousin that made everyone laugh. We're going to miss her eating off the serving utensils, squirting the condiments directly into her mouth, and getting yelled at by Geekum and Pappy for being gross. Her little quirky actions are what made her who she was, including all the arm sniffs and her obsession with feet. As I said before, Emma was so unique and so loved by so many people. In her 17 years here with us, she has made such a positive impact on so many. Now to talk about our sweet Grant with the best smile in the entire world. As you can see in pictures, he truly had a smile that can make any bad day not seem so bad. He loved being a typical boy, playing baseball, fishing. He loved his pets and doing anything outdoors. He loved everything with a heartbeat, just like his sisters, especially his German shepherds, his cat, his chickens, and even his goats. He was so responsible and do whatever he could to help out around the house. On the baseball field, he loved being in control on the pitcher's mound. He took after his big sister, Emma, and had such a positive attitude while he was on the field. He always cheered on his teammates and had a goal to work harder than anyone else on that field. His TC crew coach, Coach Gerard, recently shared a story with us about Grant that I would like to share with you. During one of his last games, Grant was having a hard time throwing strikes and had a few walks. Coach Gerard could see he was starting to get frustrated, and like any good coach, called a timeout and went out to give him a little pep talk. During the talk, Coach asked him what he was trying to throw and what was going on. Grant went on to say that he was trying to throw a slider because they were a good hitting team and he was afraid they were going to crush his fastball. Coach Gerard told him to just throw fastballs and to trust himself because his fastball was all he needed and he had what it took. Grant at first didn't think it was, but with the coach's assurance, he agreed. The next three pitches in a row were all strikes, and he struck the batter out. As soon as strike three was called, Grant looked over at his coach and gave him that infamous smile. Without saying a word, Grant said more to his coach and made an impression that would last forever. Some of Grant's favorite things to do when he was not playing baseball were to go fishing, to ride his razor side by side and quads around, and to build things. Any chance he could get, he was tying flies and casting lines and either going fishing or talking about fishing with anyone who would talk to him or listen. He also loved to use tools and help out his mom with anything around the house that he could. He was extremely creative and loved anything that required him to build things with his hands. At the last softball tournament we all attended together, Grant disappeared in the woods for a little bit between games. He came back with a working bow and arrow that he made out of a bent piece of wood, string, and tape, all the things that he found in the woods. He was so proud of his creation and so excited to show his pappy. From when he was little, Grant always had full pockets and a crazy imagination. We would always joke with him when we would see him and ask him what he had in his pockets today. He would carry around everything from tools, change, candy, dog treats, and sometimes even chicken feathers. He didn't leave without his pocket knife and wallet either. When you would see him at the softball field, He would always try to buy you something from the concession stand with his own money. Even though he only had a few dollars in his wallet, he was sure to offer to spend it on you before he would get himself anything. We will always remember Grant as the kind and gentle kid who put others before himself. He was definitely the protector of the family and always had his family's best interest at heart. He was the peacekeeper who did whatever he could to avoid conflict. He loved his family and did everything he could to help out. After games, if he thought Aubrey or Emma didn't do as well as they should or noticed they were disappointed in their performance, he would offer to go and practice with them at home. He would catch for them and make funny faces, trying to keep them entertained while still getting them to work. He truly was their biggest fan, and we know that he will be watching Aubrey play every game and cheering her on from above. Grant, we already miss your smile and your big hugs. We miss your big squeezes and your avoidance of cheek kisses. We miss that mischievous look you always had when you were going on an adventure and that big, proud smile you had when you did something good. Time with you was too short, but we are all so lucky to have had this time with you that we had. Emma and Grant have positively impacted so many people in such a short amount of time. We all know they are up in heaven as our angels watching over us and spending time with all our family and pets that we have lost. Emma and Grant, you are so loved and so missed already. Please continue to give us signs when we are feeling down and continue to provide us the strength we need to get through this life without you. For everyone here, I ask that you please keep my sister Nicole and niece Aubrey in your prayers and continue to let them know that they are not alone. Your continuous support and kindness have been such a blessing to our family. I'm going to end with a quote that Emma had posted on the headboard of her bed. Every experience God gives you, every person he puts in our lives, is the perfect preparation for the future that only he can see.
I don't know about you, but I'm glad I didn't let her go first. That was beautiful. Thank you. Let us rise and pray. Grant, we pray, Almighty God, that your servants who have journeyed from this world may by this sacrifice be cleansed and freed from any sin, and so receive the everlasting joys of the resurrection through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Before we go our separate ways, let us take leave of our brother and our sister, Nate and Emma and Grant. May our farewell express our affection for them, and may it ease our sadness and strengthen our hope that one day we shall joyfully greet them again with the love of Christ which conquers all things, destroys even death itself.
To greet you, may they speed you to
Into your hands, Father of mercies, we commend Nathan and Emma and Grant, in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, they will rise with him on the last day. We thank you for the many blessings which you bestowed upon them in this life. Some of those blessings are gathered with us here today. You are signs to us, Lord, of your goodness and of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn toward us and listen to our prayers and open the gates of paradise to your servants, and help us to remain to comfort one another with assurances of faith until we all meet in Christ and are with you and with our brother and sister forever. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
If you would, please bow your heads and pray for God's blessing. Heavenly Father, we praise you and thank you for each and every soul that's here. We thank you for the gift that they were in their lives. We thank you for their continual prayers. And through the passion of our Lord Jesus Christ, the intercession of the Blessed Virgin, Saint Joseph, and all the saints, may whatever good you do, whatever hardships you endure, may it draw you closer to one another and closer to Christ. And may others always be drawn closer to Christ through your witness and for the family. Lord Jesus, we ask you to loose a special angel around them in their time of greatest need, to watch over them, to guide them, to protect them, to encourage them, to strengthen them, to show them the right path. Let that angel be dispatched in their time of greatest need, borne on the wings of our prayers today. And may Almighty God bless you and wipe every tear from your eyes. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, let the church say amen.
Amen.
Our celebration of the Mass and of their lives is ended. Let us go forth in peace to serve the Lord with our lives.
Thanks be to God.
And thank you, one and all, to each and every soul who's here. God bless you all.